It's, you know, calm is what it is.
It's the summer cut. You're getting ready for those hot months in the summer.
I'm ready for it. But I'm weak. I'm very weak. I lost my strength. So I'm just crawling. So last class. Are you done with your classes?
Yeah. Well, we got a meeting with Donna later, but after that, we should be done.
Wow. Are you going to do a run around the house or something to celebrate?
I think I'm going to take my 9mm out and go shooting later this afternoon.
Okay. Sounds good. So I send you emails with the feedback about the tests. Remember that we need to agree, first of all, on a final exam date. So what do you want to do?
How does Sunday work?
Sunday works for me.
Sunday? Sunday afternoon, Sunday morning. Are you morning people, afternoon
Midgie, people? Midgie, you can choose the time. Any time works for me because this is...
Yeah, there is no NFL game.
The only other class that I have an exam for is modern.
We won't have any NFL games, for sure.
Let's do Sunday. Well, modern's the only other exam that I have. So Sunday works for me at any time. Midgie? Okay.
So Sunday, let's say 2 p.m.?
How about 6 a.m.?
6 a.m.?
Yeah, 2 p.m. Sunday works for me. I don't care.
2 p.m. Central Time?
Yes.
All right. So it's a three-hour exam, similar rules. Every time you need to look at the book, three-point deduction. You self-report, okay? And probably three problems, I would guess. 3 one-hour problems. All right.
Did I hear 3 10-minute problems?
3 one-hour problems.
All right.
But sounds you good. Don't need the full hour. You can do it in half of that. I know you can do this. I don't know if you need any particular, I mean, I'm willing if you needed to have like a reading day, 1 hour Zoom meeting where you can ask questions of a problem you don't know how to solve. But I mean, if you don't need it, we don't have to do it. I'm going to open a 1 hour meeting with my intro class because, you know, when they start studying, they realize that there's some holes in the middle. But you let me know, okay? By the end of the class, I need to know if you want to have another, I mean, whatever questions you have, I'm not going to teach any. Whatever questions you have. All right?
Sounds good.
So if I don't hear from you, you don't need it. Everybody will get an A+ in the final exam. And you know it all.
Oh, I plan on it.
You know it all.
I plan on it.
This is like my car mechanic that had the sign always in the counter that said, Encyclopedia Britannica for sale. My wife knows it all. this is the same. All right. So we were talking about our famous Hamilton equations. Remember?
That is correct.
Also, I haven't gotten from you anything about the catenary problem of the 2 meter long, 1 meter separated.
Oh, I have that.
I'm looking for the string.
For that problem, okay? You need to send me the solution for that problem. If possible, before the end of the semester. Even better, before the end of reading day, which is tomorrow.
You think this is 2 meter long?
Well, that's not a good example because it's not a freely hanging. It has all kinds of kinks. So you want to use a piece of string or a long chain or some other thing that is free to accommodate, that doesn't have memory. Andrew did it with a string between two chairs. Okay. And whatever you want. So basically what you need to do is take a picture of that and then create a function that describes that exactly point by point. Okay. And that will be your basically you have to be able to first show that it's a catenary, it's a hyperbolic cosine, and then you need to fit the particular catenary for that particular chain or string. All right?
Yeah.
All right. There are also some of the problems in the final exam could involve the solution of a differential equation, in which case you are allowed to use MATLAB. Okay. And basically solve the equation numerically if we have. All right? All right. So let me just switch to the textbook.
Dr. Ben, so if you drop our lowest grade, does that include the final?
No.
I hear yes.
That doesn't include the final. That's clearly, it's indicated is we drop one of the tests, and usually we have one more because we have one for chapter 6 and one for chapter 7, but in this case, we just had one for 6 and 7. So
all of us are doing fine, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Some more fine than others. So we were talking about the famous Hamiltonian, this expression, which you are expert by now. This expression for the Hamiltonian. The key that you have to do is notice the Hamiltonian is a function of position and momentum. The Lagrangian is a function of position and velocity, or rate of change, so that to be able to do this, you need to be able to write whatever the Lagrangian is in terms of p's instead of q dots, okay? Because when we do derivatives, we want to be able to do the derivatives of the Hamiltonian respect to q and the Hamiltonian respect to p, not the Hamiltonian respect to q and the Hamiltonian respect to v. Q dot, okay? So one of the jobs is to find the piece. Okay, once you find the piece, how do you find the piece? What is the procedure to find the generalized momentum? We write the Lagrangian and then how do you find P? Remember, you don't have to use a whole lot of memory. What is P in one dimension?
It's MV.
Okay. How do you go from the Lagrangian to MV?
That's like Q, V, V dot or whatever.
How do you get from kinetic minus potential to MV?
How do you take the derivative or whatever?
Respect to what?
Velocity?
Respect to R and theta and phi.
Nope.
Right?
Nope.
Oh.
If I have 1/2 MV squared, how do
you take
I get
it with respect to velocity?
Velocity.
Yeah.
So we do the derivative of the Lagrangian respect to Q dot. That's the definition of P. Okay? P is the derivative of the Lagrangian respect to Q dot. And that could be linear momentum, angular momentum, whatever it is, depending what the variable is. Remember, Qs don't have to be linear. Q can be angular or could be combination of linear and angular, whatever it is that is good, a good coordinate to use. Okay? So P is obtained from the Lagrangian by differentiating respect to Q dot, all right? And then once you have P as a function of Q dot, I mean, when you have P, then you have to write Q dot as a function of P. For instance, instead of writing the kinetic energy as 1/2 mv squared, you write it as P squared over 2m. So you, instead of writing the velocity, you write the velocity as a function of momentum. And then your Hamiltonian will only depend on Q and P. Remember, if you don't do that, when you do this partial respect to P, here it won't get any P. Okay, so this will not contribute, but it does contribute. You just have to write this in terms of P. All right? Remember, what are the Hamilton equations? How many?
Two.
There's
what
three.
Order? What order are the equations?
Two first order.
Two first order. Lagrangian is one second order per degree of freedom. Hamiltonians are two first order per degree of freedom. What are the two equations? Remember, what is the Hamiltonian depend on? P and Q. Okay? That's what depends on. Most cases, it doesn't depend explicitly on time. So just Q and P. So, of course, you have to differentiate respect to Q. What do you get when you differentiate respect to Q?
When you differentiate P with respect to Q?
When you differentiate, we agree that there are two equations, the Hamilton equation. Both involve the differentiating the Hamiltonian respected the variables they depend on, which is Q and P. Okay? So what happens when you differentiate the Hamiltonian respect to Q? What's the partial of the Hamiltonian respect to Q? I hear crickets.
Is it momentum squared?
What is, if this will be a one dimensional problem, always think one dimension. Okay, imagine the potential is mgy. And I do the derivative, the Hamiltonian respect to y. What will I get?
With the partial with respect to q would be p dot, right?
Yeah. And that's what?
The derivative of momentum. So like angular momentum, right?
What is the rate of change of momentum?
Force.
Momentum principle. Force dp dt.
I said force at first.
Force is the rate of change of momentum. But when you do the derivative of the Hamiltonian, okay, the Hamiltonian when it's in the normal form is kinetic plus potential. No? When you differentiate respect to the coordinate Q, in general, you don't expect the kinetic energy depend on Q. The kinetic energy depends on Q dot, but not on Q. Okay? So most of the time, it's going to involve the derivative of the potential respect to Q. When you differentiate the potential respect to Q, what do you get? If I differentiate potential energy respect to the coordinate, what do I get?
The momentum or the dot.
We discussed this for 20 minutes last class.
The mg.
What is the derivative? What is the derivative of the potential respect to Q?
Did we say mg last time?
No, in general.
Right, it's the force.
It's the force, except what?
So if it's the potential, it would just be mg.
It's the force or what?
Mgy.
What is the force in that direction? Equals?
Zero.
Is this true?
Yeah.
That is 100% correct.
No.
It's dl or whatever.
No, wouldn't it be dh, dq?
Okay, let's recap. I'm trying to make you remember things so that you don't lose points every time you need to write something, okay? So, what is the Hamiltonian? The Hamiltonian is in the cases in which the Lagrangian does not depend explicitly on time and the transformation of the coordinates is direct, homogeneous. You can go from Cartesian to the Qs and from the Qs to Cartesian. Then this is simply T plus U. We agree? Hamiltonian is T plus U. If I do the derivative of the Hamiltonian respect to Q, since the kinetic energy usually, not always, but usually does not depend on Q, depends on Q dot, then it will be the derivative of U respect to Q. Okay? Differentiating the Hamiltonian respect to Q will usually involve differentiating the potential energy respect to Q. When I differentiate the potential energy respect to X, let's say, what do I get?
Mg.
Blah, G. mg is one type of force in one case. In general, if I give you potential energy, for instance, a spring, what is the potential energy for a spring?
The k over m.
Potential energy for a spring.
K over R.
Oh my gosh.
Or K, this is the, yeah, it's
this
K
is
over...
the quiz. You did the quiz.
No, it's KX.
It's KX.
Potential energy.
Yeah, and the quiz, it was negative K over N, or K over L or whatever.
No, it's KX.
Yeah, it's KX.
KX squared?
Yeah, isn't it like KX?
1/2 KX squared.
Can y'all hear me?
Oh, the sound went out.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Thank you. What is the potential energy of two masses connected with a spring?
Minus KX squared.
No.
Oh, it was minus KX squared plus the other X squared. Yeah. Right?
What is the potential energy associated with a spring?
1/2 KX squared.
1/2 KX squared. Remember?
Yes.
Yes, sure. Okay, so for a spring, you have 1/2 KX squared. What is the derivative of the potential respect to X? What is this derivative?
It's just KX.
And the force is KX?
Yeah, well, if you take the derivative, then it'd be 1/2 × 2 KX.
Yeah, I'm asking about the sign. Is the force KX or minus KX?
Minus KX.
So where is the minus here? So the force is minus the derivative. So if I take the derivative of the potential, I get KX. If I put a minus in front, I get minus KX, which is the force of the spring. There is always a negative sign between the force.
It went out again.
Hi, Andrew.
Dr. Ben. Dr. Ben.
Dude, what if he goes off to the rest of the class?
Based on this, if I do the Hamiltonian respect to Q, what do I get?
You get the
minus
force.
Minus KX.
In general,
you get the
what
force.
Do you get? What did we say?
I'm not sure what the question
get,
is.
I mean,
the negative
the
momentum.
Force is minus du dq. We agree on that?
Yeah.
Well, if I do not du dq, I do dh dq. What changes?
The sign.
The sign.
Yeah, so what do I need to do?
The negative becomes a positive.
Yeah, so you need minus p dot.
Oh, I couldn't tell what you were asking. My bad.
The force minus dh dq is equal to the rate of change of momentum. Force equals rate of change of momentum. So one of the equations is that p is minus dh dq. P dot, for each coordinate, p dot has a minus in front. Notice there is a dot here. There is no dot there. This is the coordinate. So if I differentiate the Hamiltonian respect to Q, whatever the Q I'm using, Q1, Q2, whatever, I get the rate of change of momentum associated with the coordinate. So if this is the coordinate x, this will be the rate of change of px. If this is the coordinate r, this will be the rate of change of pr, p sub r, whatever is the coordinate. All right? That's one of the Hamilton's equations. It's nothing else than Newton's second law in a more complicated language. The rate of change of momentum is the force. Agree?
Yes.
Yes.
Well, since we agreed last time and still we are in the same place, we did this for 20 minutes last class. All right. So what is the other derivative we need to do? We made the derivative respect to Q. Now we need a derivative respect to
Q dot.
No, P. The Hamiltonian does not depend on Q dot.
On R.
What are the variables of the Hamiltonian?
The P and Q.
Yeah. So one derivative is in respect to Q. What's the other derivative?
The with P.
P.
Yeah. Yeah. So what is the derivative of the Hamiltonian respect to P?
Q dot.
Q dot. Look at that. So you see how this game works. If you have one equation, which is if I differentiate respect to Q, I get P dot. If I differentiate respect to P, I get Q dot. Okay? I exchange the variables, except for those pesky negative signs. That's why I'm insisting, because if you just write plus and plus on both, you're going to get the wrong equation. Understood?
Yep. Yeah.
So what do we use this for? Well, in principle, what we have to do is we write the Lagrangian. Okay? First step before writing the Lagrangian, what's the first step on any of these treatments based on the Lagrangian mechanics? What do we need to calculate first or count first? What's the first thing we look for when we are given a problem?
Degrees of freedom.
Degrees of freedom. For each degree of freedom, one coordinate, one Q. Okay? So if I have a pendulum that moves in one plane, it has only one degree of freedom. If it's a pendulum that can move in space, not just in one plane, how many degrees of freedom does it have? If I can pull it out of the plane and just make it move around in any direction, what would be the number of coordinates you need?
Three.
Are you sure?
Four.
If it's just a particle, two. Yeah.
Two. You need
another. Are you talking about like just two. One point in space?
You need one for the departure from the vertical and the other one to find the, in which plane.
Oh, sorry. So you
have a theta and a phi, okay? Why you don't need three? Because the string doesn't change the length. Okay?
I didn't know that it was attached to a screen.
Okay. Now, if instead of a string, you have a spring, a pendulum that is not with the length of a string, but with an elastic string or with a spring, how many degrees of freedom you have?
Three.
Because you don't know the distance either. So it's like a particle that has 3 degrees of freedom. Okay? So if for some reason it's forced to oscillate in a plane and the length is fixed, it has 1 degree of freedom, the angle with the vertical. If it can oscillate at a fixed length, but not constrained to a plane, then you need another coordinate to know where are you in the other direction. Okay? And if the length is variable and you don't know what it is, then you have a third coordinate. So one of the problems you have in the book is, for instance, to solve this situation, which I will encourage you to work very carefully. You have a spring acting like a pendulum. So this point is fixed, and this is a spring that has a certain thin constant. And here is the mass. Okay? And for now, we will assume that this is forced to move in a plane, like an ideal plane. So we're going to pull it out and let it go, not kick it in a different direction. So that's a typical Lagrangian mechanics or Hamiltonian mechanic problem. You need to be able to solve this problem using Lagrangian mechanics and then using Hamiltonian mechanics. So, following the steps, how many degrees of freedom?
Three.
We said it oscillates in a plane.
We're gonna pull from the mass,
we're gonna stretch the spring, you're gonna move it to the side and you let go. So it will oscillate in whatever plane you start. Okay? So it has only two. It has the angle with the vertical, theta, whatever it is, and the length, which is a function of time. The length of the distance between the suspension point and the mass. And that oscillates or changes, so it can move also. Okay? So we have two coordinates, which could be theta and r, if you want. That would be a more normal notation. Theta and r, where r is the location of the mass relative to the support. How far is from here, from the whole point here. All right? So, how do you write the Lagrangian for this system?
The Lagrangian?
Remember, to do the if I ask you to do the Hamiltonian, you still have to write the Lagrangian. Okay? Except the case is obvious that the Hamiltonian happens to be T plus Q, then you don't have to write the Lagrangian. But you have to make sure that you can do that. So in case of doubt, you start with the Lagrangian. Now, in the exam, I'm going to ask you to solve by both methods. So you will always have to find the Lagrangian first. So what is the Lagrangian of this system?
You got to do T plus Q.
T plus or T minus?
T minus U.
T minus U. So what is T?
Half.
What velocities does this object have?
It has mx squared plus my squared. No, yeah, x squared plus y squared the z squared or whatever. Or v in the x, y, z, right?
Yeah, but you need to express it in terms of theta and r.
Theta dot.
So it's 1/2 m squared times
m squared,
theta squared plus theta squared.
Theta is not a distance. I saw you in your test. You have a mess with the units. The velocity associated with theta is not theta dot, because theta dot is not a velocity. It's an angular velocity. To write the velocity, you need to write some distance times the angular velocity. So what is the distance you need?
L.
Or R, let's call it R.
R
is the distance. Yeah. So you have an R theta dot for the tangential velocity, the velocity of the motion around the arc, and then you have what? What are the velocity you have?
R sine squared.
This can change.
And then you have the velocity from the spring oscillation.
Yeah, so that will be R dot. Really? If this changes, you have a radial velocity. Now, when you calculate kinetic energy, because these two are perpendicular, you have to write as the square of this plus the square of that. You don't add the velocities, you add the square because you want the magnitude of the velocity. And all that multiplied times what? This is basically V squared. Then you need M over 2. No?
All that.
1/2 of the mass.
Yeah, 1/2 M.
Okay? So in terms of R and theta, which were our two coordinates, you have a radial velocity and a tangential velocity. You cannot write theta dot. Theta dot is not a velocity. You need a length divided by second to get velocity. Okay, so that's the kinetic energy. What's the potential energy? That's T. What is U? How many interactions you have to write the potential?
Two? Would it be half?
Before you just had gravity, no? What was the potential energy due to gravity?
Just mg.
Potential energy, not force. Potential energy. Do we agree that mg is a force?
Yeah. Yes.
But we need potential energy.
Mgy.
Mgy. What is y? Yeah. To write as mgy. Which way does y point?
L would be like the initial resting rate of the spring.
Well, I mean, at any moment, you are at a certain height. But where do you measure it from? The only fixed point here is the top here.
You measure it from the initial.
When you have a pendulum, then the bottom of the motion is the lowest point. But here, this is variable. There is no bottom. You can go anywhere you want. Okay. So in those cases, it's better to measure the potential respect to the support because it's the only point that doesn't move. You understand that if you have a pendulum, you can use the bottom of the pendulum as your y equals zero, because that's the lowest you're going to go. Okay, but if this changes, this is not the lowest you can go. Okay, so in those cases in which the bottom is not fixed, it depends on how far you launch. Okay, then it's better to use the top, which is fixed. Now, if the top is fixed, to write the potential mgy, y has to be positive up. Basically, you have more potential energy the higher you are respect to the ground. So if this is the potential energy, this coordinate is negative. You understand that? The vertical position of this object is a negative value. Do you agree?
I agree.
If this is your, and to write mgy, you need to go up positive, then this coordinate is negative. What is the value? How do you calculate where this of what is that length? If I R and theta, what is that? Really?
Cosine.
Cosine of theta.
Cosine.
Adjacent divided by R. All right?
Yeah.
So Y is going to be mg
cosine
minus R cosine.
Minus cosine theta.
Okay. Very important that you put the minus. The lower you are, the more negative is the potential. So the potential is minus mg R cosine theta for gravity. How do you write it for the spring? What did we say?
It'd be opposite of that.
What is the potential energy associated with the spring? thing we discussed about 6 minutes
one
ago?
One half kx squared.
Okay, so it's going to be plus 1/2 k. And what is h? Well, h is the length r it's minus r. The lateral length l naught, whatever is the thing, squared. You have to subtract from the current length of the string, which is r, the unstretched length l naught, and then you get the stretch, k h. So you have minus mgr cosine theta for potential energy due gravity, plus 1/2 k r minus l naught squared for the spring energy. And we already have the kinetic energy. We can do the difference. T minus u. Can you write T minus u?
Doing it right now.
Yes.
All right. So once you have T minus u, you have the Lagrangian. Now we need to write what? The Lagrange equations, which are from memory. What does the Lagrange equation say in general? If you like have a Q.
DL dQ dot, minus DDT DL dQ dot is equal to zero.
Okay. DL dQ minus DDT DL dQ dot equals zero. So let's do that for R and for theta. And you need to practice this, okay? Because you have 3 hours. If you don't practice this, you're going to take 2 hours to do one problem. Do you recognize this problem you're working on?
Yeah.
Have you seen it somewhere?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We basically did the same thing in the double pendulum problem.
Uh-huh. So, problem 715. That's the problem.
715?
Mm-hmm. That's the problem. It's called in L instead of R. You can call it whatever you want. You recognize the kinetic and the potential. That's the kinetic. That's the potential. The spring term where L is R and B is L naught, the natural length, and minus mgl, notice the minus, minus mgl cosine theta. So you should have a Lagrangian that looks like this, except that instead of L, it should say R. Agree?
Yes.
All right. So now you have to do the Lagrange equation. Derivative of the Lagrangian respect to L or R. Derivative of the Lagrangian respect to R dot. Derivative of the Lagrangian respect to theta. Derivative of the Lagrangian respect to theta dot. And write the two equations. Possible in less than 5 minutes. Ooh. Now, in other problems that have the same pendulum idea, you might be moving the point of suspension. You can move it up, you can move it down, you can move it sideways, you can oscillate the point of contact, you can accelerate it. You have all these multiple variations of the problem.
Would it be like half m r dot squared plus r squared theta dot squared minus a half r minus, I guess we called it l naught squared, like minus mgl cosine theta?
Well, more or less like this, you mean?
Yeah.
This is dd theta of dl, the derivative of the Lagrangian.
Oh, wait, I'm called, sorry, I called, is it supposed to be L? I had R.
Yeah,
R.
Use R, don't use it.
Yeah, I used R.
So, the derivative of Lagrangian respect to R dot is simply this term. That's the only place where R dot appears. So, that's going to be mR dot. The derivative respect to time of mr dot is mr double dot. Do you agree?
Yes.
And on the minus, you can send it to the other side of plus. It's simply, this is the derivative of Lagrangian respect to...
But are you writing something?
Respect to r.
I can't see the screen if you're writing something.
This equation. This is...
I can't even see your mouse.
Oh, yeah. All we can see is the textbook still.
You don't see the solutions?
No.
No.
Oh, okay. Well, that's... Can you see it?
Yeah.
I can now, yes.
Okay. So that's what I'm talking about, except that it's R instead of L. That's the only difference. So this is ddt dl respect to l dot. So this is the term ddt dl dr dot. And on the right hand side is dl derivative of Lagrangian respect to r. R appears in three places. R appears here, here, and here. So you have three terms that come from the derivative with respect to the value. This term comes from here, this term comes from here, and there is a k missing here, okay? There's a type. There should be a k here.
Yep.
So that's the R equation.
Wait, where did that middle part? Where did that middle part come from?
The potential energy, 1/2 kL minus B squared.
Well, I know that, but like when you differ, or like when you differentiate that, do you?
Well, it's the derivative of minus 1/2 k L minus R minus L naught square respect to L R. So it's the derivative of everything, which drops the 2, times the derivative of this inside, which is a 1. That's the derivative of R.
Yeah, I'll see that. All right, I'll get
that. So that's why you get this.
Yeah.
It's 1/2 times 2 k l minus b times the derivative of that, which is r minus b, which is r, this is 1. So that's that. And here you just drop the r. In general, will be the equation to be written. This minus all that equals 0. but he's already trying to make it easy, look easier that way. This will be a minus. This will be all in one big parenthesis equals Z. The theta term is easier because there is only one place where theta appears, and there is only one place that theta dot appears. So that's easier. So what is the equation for theta? You need to find
B D T. Theta would just be MGR or minus yes. MGR sine theta.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And that's the only term we get for that one.
Yeah, but the derivative with respect to theta dot depends on this term. You need to find the Lagrangian respect to theta minus the dt de Lagrangian respect to theta dot. Agree?
Yes.
Yeah.
All right. Well, wouldn't it just be mr theta dot for the...
Well, mr squared theta dot mm-hmm. respect to time. You recognize it?
Yes.
Yeah.
In reality, it should be this plus that equals zero. But you know, that's the same thing. So these are the two equations once you cancel m's and l's. Like here is an l squared, and here is an r squared, here is an r. You can do all kinds of cleaning if you can. And be careful that this is a variable, okay? So be careful. You can cancel the masses. Notice the masses drop except here. There is the famous K over M, which is the frequency square of the spring, okay? So this is your system of equations obtained using the Lagrange method. How easy is to solve this?
Hard.
Very hard. Can you solve it with some function that you know?
Euler.
I thought the function, it wouldn't work.
Yeah, you can't integrate it. You have to do it, only you can do it numerically. Okay?
Let's go.
Even if the angle is small, you can only do it numerically. Even if the angle is small. Because you have these terms here and here that are screwing up your, this is a nonlinear equation. R dot times theta dot is a nonlinear term. Okay? And theta dot squared R is also a nonlinear term. The variable times a variable or the variable to some power is nonlinear. So the only thing you can do besides writing it in MATLAB or some other method to integrate this is to see if you made a mistake. And that's very important. Before you go into computational, you need to make sure that the equations are right, that the signs are right, and the terms are right. So how can you tell? Well, we always look at the extreme cases, we know the answer. So what is the first extreme case that we know the answer?
I'm sorry, could you repeat the question, please?
Yes. First, do we know a simpler case that we already know what the equation looks like?
For a regular pendulum.
Yeah. So what happens in a regular pendulum? The length doesn't change. So L double dot is zero. This term still is there, but this is a constant now. It's the length of the string, basically, instead of being a variable, okay? And this term is constant, because if the length is constant, this is a constant, okay?
That's just
a constant will not change your equation. It just changes by a number, okay? And what you get is simply the equation for a pendulum, okay? Possibly the equation for the pendulum. So this is the equation you get. And then you have this equation. Now, what does this equation say if the length doesn't change? Well, this term disappears.
That's constant.
And this is
the constant part of the sine function.
So basically, this is the equation for the pendulum. The second derivative is minus g over l sine of the arc. So the second equation is the equation of the pendulum, okay, if the length doesn't change. The first equation is harder to tell what it is because it involves the radial equation when the radius doesn't change. So it's not very useful, okay? But it's still a valid equation. Now, what is the other case? So pendulum will be this equation, second equation with this term zero. Makes sense. If the length doesn't change, it doesn't matter if it's a spring or not. Nothing changes, okay? So what is the other extreme case? You have a pendulum and a spring, okay, together. We already said if you don't have a spring. What happens if you don't have
a pendulum? The other case would be if you have a spring but not a pendulum.
So basically, we put like a spring
and just
the spring vertical
and
we let it oscillate up and down. All right?
Yeah.
In that case, all the thetas are zero and all the theta dots and theta double dots are zero. So this will be zero equals zero, nothing very usable. Okay? But this equation now that has the spring will be what? Well, this will be the length of the spring. This will be zero now, because theta is constant, equal to zero, okay? And this is constant, because the cosine of this is what? Well, cosine of one, cosine of zero. So what you get is double dot, the length of the spring, r double dot, this term is not there, plus k over m, r minus l naught, minus g equals zero. Well, that's the equation of a pendulum hanging vertical. Okay? That's the equation of a spring hanging vertical. If the spring is horizontal, you get simply r double dot is minus k over m of the stretch. Okay? But because it's hanging vertical, you have the stretch additional 32 gravity. So these two extreme cases work. That's not a guarantee that your equations are right. But if that doesn't work, your equations are wrong. Okay, so if the simple case is wrong, then your equations are wrong. So it doesn't work to put
back to the drawing board.
Because you are
before if we go and calculate
garbage in, you're gonna get garbage out. Okay. So you don't know if this is right, but you can tell that it's not obviously wrong. It has the right units, everything here is an acceleration. And everything here is an angular acceleration. So the equations have the right units. You didn't drop an m, you didn't drop an r, or something else. And the terms make sense. When you have a pure pendulum without spring, this is the equation with this zero. When you have a pure spring without oscillation, this is the equation for without this and with the one here. That's the equation of a pendulum that is hanging vertical. Sorry, a spring that can get back. Now, to solve this problem is a pain. Okay, if I tell you I move this object 30 degrees and I stretch the spring to, I don't know, 50% of the natural length and let go, it's going to oscillate left and right. And at the same time, it's going to oscillate as a spring, close and far. And the two oscillations are superimposed. So it's a very complicated combined oscillation. Okay? Combined oscillation. In particular, if this system you excited, for instance, by holding the top and making it oscillate up and down, you can generate different resonances. You can resonate with the spring, or you can resonate with the pendulum. And you can excite very large oscillation. Sadly, if we were a C1, I would show you that. Sadly, you'll take my word for this because I don't have a pendulum with a spring in my home.
Well, you don't have one in your home? I got them everywhere.
I should. any physicist should have that. But I left in a hurry. So anyways, do we need to meet tomorrow or you're okay?
I think we're good.
All right. So if you have any questions, send me an email and I will try to reply as fast as I can. If not, we will see you Sunday at 2 p.m. Central.
Oh, Lord. Are we going to have MATLAB on there?
Yeah, we are going to shine so much that I'm going to have to use my dark glasses. You're going to shine
so much. Are we 100% having MATLAB on there?
Well, one problem will involve MATLAB for sure.
Oh God.
Well, I mean, why did we work all this semester on this? You need to be able to use it. Man. So I will give you some initial condition, and you will solve the problem by entering the differential equation using maybe ODE45 or some other similar method to solve the motion. All in probably an hour time. So if you don't know how to do it, this is a good time to make sure you learn how to do it.
That's good.
All right. Well, perfect. Go to your last meeting with Dr. Donev, who is leaving. So give him a big goodbye. And, we'll see you Sunday. Let me know. And we'll see you then. All right?
All right.
It's been a wild ride. I appreciate it, Dr. Ben.
Yeah.
Good luck with your exams. And I hope when you see the arch, you will remember mechanics. All right. See you guys.
Yes, sir.
Good.